Wrapping up UFC 236 here in Atlanta. What a night. In particular, the last two fights. Dustin Poirier is the new interim UFC lightweight champion, and Israel Adesanya is the new UFC interim middleweight champion. We can go either way here. We could start with Dustin. That's a huge deal. We could start with Israel. Yeah. Let's give Dustin the nod. He was the main event. What a performance out of him. Did you score in his favor, first and foremost?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, I had him win four of the five rounds. I even gave him a 10-8 in the first round, which I think I was on the minority of. But I was able to watch from press row, and just the weight of his punches compared to Max Holloway's. And, you know, you and I talked about this before the fight started. What is something that we're going to be looking for when the fight starts? And I said, well, we're so quick sometimes to say, oh, it's only 10 pounds. He's moving up from 145 to 155. What's the big difference? There is a difference, you know, and I think that was an advantage that Dustin Poirier had tonight, that he had been in there with Justin Gaethje, with Eddie Alvarez, with Anthony Pettis. He knew what 155 feels like. His body has been calibrated to fight at 155. Max Holloway was sort of finding this out on the fly, and Max Holloway did not look bad. He looked like the Max Holloway that we have come to know at featherweight. His pace was high, but he never hit. I shouldn't say never, but it was hard for him to really change the course of the fight at any time because he just lacked the power. You saw the power in Dustin. You didn't see it from Max tonight.
It did feel like it was a lightweight fighting a featherweight in there, right?
It did.
From a power standpoint, but also from a visual standpoint. Mm-hmm. I'm shocked that I'm saying this, but it almost feels like Max is a true featherweight after all.
I don't think so.
Okay.
I just think Max is a talented fighter. Max is still growing. He's only 27 years old.
Yeah.
I think give Max, I mean, how long has Dustin Poirier been fighting 155? We spoke about that this week. It's 2015. You give Max the next 4 years to turn into a lightweight, I'm sure this would be a different story, him fighting Dustin Poirier. But again, I just think we are so dismissive of it sometimes. And hey, certain guys can do it. We've seen Conor McGregor did it. He went from 145 to 155, no problems. Knocked out Eddie Alvarez. But I think Max Holloway was going up against a guy who was on a tear, a guy with a lot of confidence, a guy who was very familiar with 155 pounds. And when we are talking about the best of the best fighting in each division, those tiny little nuances matter. And I'm not saying that's the only reason Dustin Poirier won the fight tonight, but I do think it was a major advantage in his favor.
This feels like a true Cinderella story in the sense that you have a guy in Dustin Poirier who debuted in the UFC on short notice. It was supposed to be Josh Grispy against Jose Aldo at UFC 125 for the featherweight title, the very first featherweight title fight in UFC history. Aldo gets hurt. Poirier slides in, ruins those plans against Grispy, beats Grispy, and then it takes him 22 fights, the second longest streak ever for a fighter to get a UFC title fight, just behind Michael Bisping's 26. And he's had so many ups and downs in his career, and it felt like if he didn't win this fight, it might never come his way, right?
Yeah.
He had to win this one. And so it's hard not to be happy for the guy right now.
Oh, it's impossible not to be happy for him, because on top of that, he's also just a great guy.
Yeah.
You know, selling his fight kit and for charity, and he's a family man. The way he treats his daughter, calls her Sweet Pea, is a very likable guy.
Right.
But you say ups and downs. I don't even know if I would really necessarily even say that. There weren't that many downs. You know, throughout that whole process, he lost, what, three fights in the UFC? It's just inopportune times. You know, that's how cruel this sport can be sometimes, is that you can win whatever his record is in the UFC now, 17-3 or whatever it is, but those three losses were enough to prolong his title run for 8 years. I mean, that is just the sport in which we're dealing with, and the division in which we're dealing with. That lightweight division is so stacked, and everything that's going on with Conor McGregor and Khabib Nurmagomedov, it prolonged it for Dustin Poirier, but he hung in there. And isn't it fitting that, you know, for months, maybe even the last year, his hashtag has been paid in full, paid in full, paid in full. That was very appropriate tonight.
I saw him earlier this evening as he was walking out. He said, I had 25 minutes to make life fair, and I think he accomplished.
That's a heck of a quote.
Yes, I think he accomplished that mission. You know, I remember back at UFC 178, the build-up to that fight, he was so confident that he would end the hype train that is Conor. Mm-hmm. He lost in very quick and devastating fashion, and I was wondering at the time if that would break him. Mm-hmm. And I know that was a long time ago, and he also stumbled against Michael Johnson. So like you said, not that many losses, but it always felt like they were devastating losses. And on the cusp, he was on the cusp of doing something great. He finally got over that hump, which reminds me of a Michael Bisping-like story, right?
Yeah.
Maybe he was always going to be the bridesmaid. Now not the official champion. I was talking to his coach, Mike Brown, in the back, and he said, you know, I never really liked those interim belts until my guys started to win them, Colby Covington, Dustin Poirier. Now he's all about them.
Yeah, they're
but
not so bad, right?
It feels like a great moment, even though it's an interim title.
Well, let me ask you this, because we've been very complimentary of Dustin Poirier, as we should.
Yeah.
And the guy has been through a lot, and he's persevered, and this probably took a lot longer than it should have, but here he is, and you saw how happy he was, you know, standing at this desk after the fights, and there were a couple times where he just patted the belt.
Sure.
You can tell it means so much to him. Does he have a chance against Khabib Nurmagomedov?
I think he does. Obviously, that fight is 5 months away, so it's not a lot of time, I think, to prepare for someone. You know, he has to get over this, a little banged up. I think he does. He looked really good in this fight. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I would favor Khabib. I think Khabib is one of the best fighters in the world, most dominant fighters in the world. He's undefeated in the UFC. Mm-hmm. He'll be fighting in a very pro-Khabib country. He'll be in the United Arab Emirates in Abu Dhabi. That's the plan as of right now. Interesting, by the way, did you see Khabib's tweet about Dustin saying that he didn't agree with the scorecards? He thought it was a lot closer than 49-46.
I missed that one.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
But he did say, I'll see you in September. So it doesn't seem like there's any footsie going on. Of course, like clockwork, there's Conor McGregor tweeting and saying, now you can get your fight against Nate.
Yeah,
which was a bizarre curveball.
He was tweeting before the event, too, saying, hey, everybody watch these two gentlemen who I defeated previously in my career.
He's doing this amazing gimmick now where after every UFC fight, he somehow finds a way to insert himself into the narrative.
Yep.
That is Conor for you.
That is what he's been up to.
Do you foresee any scenario in which Dustin doesn't fight Khabib next?
I really don't, especially if Khabib has already come out and said, see you in September.
Yeah.
You know, I think, you know, we make a lot of people make fun of these interim titles. They say they don't like them. What value do they have? Well, this is the value that they need to have right now. And we've seen it just recently, even with Colby Covington, that it doesn't always mean anything. But I do think that, you know, I spoke to Dana White after the event, and he said, yeah, Khabib is you know, he's not a guy to turn down fights. He still has a few issues with his teammates being suspended, as we all know. But I think as far as an opponent, he's open to it. And that is the fight that I am anticipating seeing next.
Who would you favor in it?
You got to favor Khabib.
Yeah.
But, you know, Khabib is a tough matchup for anybody. But Dustin, with the experience, the well-roundedness, and the power that he showed in this fight, I mean, that is the type of power to change a fight. Even though he didn't get a finish over Max Holloway, you know, I think that was a testament to how durable Max Holloway can be at this weight. You know, he has the power to stop Khabib's progression, and then we see what happens in a fight.
Yeah, so Max Holloway's 13-fight winning streak is snapped. Now the tie for the current longest winning streak in the UFC is Khabib Nurmagomedov and Tony Ferguson. You still kind of feel for Ferguson in all of this, right? Because he was once the interim champion at lightweight, lost the belt after he tripped over that now infamous cord. But we understand that he's not really available right now. He's going through some personal
problems.
Well,
he tweeted tonight as well.
He did, yes.
And I asked Dana White, you know, what do you need to see out of this guy? I mean, even as a promoter, what do you need to know about him in order to feel comfortable booking him a fight? And I don't think Dana White even knows that answer. You know, I think that's conversations that have to take place between the UFC and the promotion and Tony Ferguson. But I do think it's great and it's positive to see that Tony Ferguson is wanting to be engaged and he's tweeting about fights. And I hope he's, you know, close to that.
On the flip side, let me ask you about Max quickly here. Would it be fair to say his next fight's going to be at 145?
I think that's fair to say. You know, and again, I wouldn't mind if he stayed at 155, and I don't think he would have any problems being at 155. He would find a home there. He would find that comfort zone and where he needs his body to be. But he's got that belt, and it's hard to just drop the belt and say, okay, you know, now I'm going to focus on 155. When you have that belt and you know you can make that weight, which he has always said, I can make that weight, then, yeah, I anticipate him moving down.
It's going to be interesting to see who emerges as his next opponent. I think if Alex Volkanovski wins on May 11th, he should be next. If Aldo wins, I don't want to see that fight for a third time.
No.
So it's going to be interesting to see. I mean, there's a lot of pressure on Volkanovski to get by Aldo because I think it's hard to argue against him.
But I think it's Edgar, though. Don't you think?
Not a lot of momentum there.
There's not, but technically he is ranked that high.
Yeah.
It was supposed to happen before. I think Max that's a fight that he wants. He understands what Frankie represents. Frankie's not getting any younger.
Right.
That's what my guess would be, is that we'll see Frankie and Max.
Okay. Now let's talk about the co-main event. What a fight. Right now it is April 14th. I think that's the fight of the year as of right this moment.
It's going to be tough to top.
Yeah, what an incredible performance from both Israel Adesanya and Kelvin Gastelum. In the end, Adesanya wins via decision. I'll ask you the same question that I asked you at the top. Did you score it for Israel Adesanya?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
Yeah, I had it tied two rounds.
Yep.
Going into the fifth. And what did Israel Adesanya do? He didn't just win the fifth. He went out and knocked him down three times. Had the referee stopped the fight, I wouldn't have had, you know, I would have been like, cool, yeah, I'm good with that stoppage. And he took a 10-8. I think that's the type of round where that really starts to define your career, you know, where your back was against the wall. It's a title fight against a veteran. He's put you into deep waters that you have not been in yet in MMA. And you responded with a 10-8 round. I think that was very telling and a big statement by Israel Adesanya.
Yeah, I thought it came down to the third round in that one. I was actually watching it with Chael. Chael scored it for Kelvin, although they're good friends, so maybe he's a little biased
on
that one.
His scorecards with a grain of salt.
Yes, and then he scored it a 10-8 in the fifth, which would lead to a draw. Yeah. I had the third for Adesanya, so I agree with your scorecard. 2-2 going into the fifth, and what a performance in the fifth round from Adesanya. And you saw him afterwards, very banged up. Mm-hmm. But now, all of a sudden, it leads to this monumental fight, right? Mm-hmm. In Australia, probably. New Zealand versus Australia. Yep. And Whitaker has ties. He's born in New Zealand as well.
Right.
Of course, now Israel Adesanya is the second African-born champion a month after Kamaru Usman did it. And right. So that's amazing for that country as well. But this just feels like if they would have told us in the back, you know, in a secret corner of this arena, who they were kind of hoping would win,
yeah.
I feel like it was Israel Adesanya. Like, there is something special about this guy.
Yeah, and it's never really too hard to say who would the UFC want to win. You know, you can always kind of play that game and you can get to an answer. It doesn't always work out that way. This one has worked out, you know, and they wanted it in February, I think. You know, they wanted that moment where Adesanya could beat Anderson Silva, Robert Whittaker could get past Kelvin Gastelum, and you bring Adesanya into the octagon, you'd have those two square off, and it didn't happen due to crazy, unforeseen circumstances, right? But I think we're back there now, and I definitely think that this is the type of fight that can be a spectacle, that can be at a stadium, and can be that type of fight that even here in the States, I think will give some people pause and they'll want to take notice and pay attention to this fight.
Every time I do, you know, interviews with, you know, radio stations in some random market, right, they always ask me, who's the next star? It feels like we found that guy. Like, the first guy I would say right now would be Adesanya. Like, Khabib has already arrived, but as far as, like, the next guy, it feels like Adesanya is that guy, right?
Yeah, I think that there are some guys that we would have said that about, that, hey, this guy has the potential to be the next star. I think Brian Ortega was sort of on that mold, undefeated, had a big fight coming up against Max Holloway. You know, he was actually favored to win that fight. We saw what happened there. Darren Till was that guy for a little bit. Now Darren Till, obviously, that two-fight losing streak. We'll have to see how he bounces back. Israel Adesanya was one round away from being the next guy that was like, hey, he was going to be the guy, but he didn't quite get it done. He lost to the veteran, but he stepped up and had that amazing fifth round. And that's why I can't put enough emphasis on how impressed I am of that fifth round. That is the type of round where you just think about everything that's at stake, all the chips that are on the table, and the fact that Kelvin Gastelum is just a guy that you apparently cannot finish. And he had that type of performance in the last 5 minutes.
Nice to see Whitaker emerge on social media. He's not that type, but he did say, congratulations, I'll see you later on this summer. Right now, who would you favor in that matchup?
I think still Whitaker.
Yeah.
But Israel's crossing over into that territory where you don't want to bet against the
guy,
huh?
Yeah, he's now 17-0 as an MMA professional. He is 6-0 in essentially, 14 months? It's an incredible run. And he's now engaged in this back and forth, not only with Whitaker, but John Jones as well. He was asked at the post-fight press conference about Jones's tweets, and he said, I'll deal with that later. Tonight it's about Kelvin and I. But Jones continues to tweet about him. Did you see that?
Yes, I
clearly
did.
His interest has peaked. I don't know if he's just trying to get some headlines, but something is going on here.
I think it's great for Israel Adesanya to be tweeting about John Jones.
Yes.
I don't think it's great for him to sign a contract to fight John Jones anytime soon.
Right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's go with Whitaker first. All right. Any other performance that we should talk about? We had Khalil Roundtree with a nice win. There were some other performances throughout the undercard. Alexandre Pantoja with a nice win. Any other one that you want to highlight before we say goodbye?
Man, I am having such a hard time even remembering the rest of the card after what happened in the co-main in Maine. Our boy Boston Salmon did not fare too well.
Yes, that was a very quick finish, unfortunately. Alan Joban very upset after the judges didn't give it to him, gave it to Dwight Grant. I know you spoke to him. He was fired up, right?
Yeah, yeah. Well, saying that he was going into a contract negotiation after this, and he felt that he was pushing the pace, and he felt like the judges robbed him not only of half of his paycheck tonight, but of his contract negotiations. I mean, we've heard that story before. Unfortunately, that's how this sport works, and he was very emotional about it.
And how about Nikita Krylov getting revenge 5 years later with
pretty
his
cool.
own submission against Ovince St. Preux? So fun night. And by the way, kudos to this crowd. I mean, chanting for Poirier, chanting for Holloway, chanting for Adesanya. None of those people are from Atlanta, right?
Yeah.
And they were chanting. They were loud. They came here early. It was a very impressive crowd when they were last here. For UFC 201, it wasn't a very loud and boisterous crowd. I thought tonight the Atlanta crowd really was impressive. And UFC, by the way, giving Fight of the Night awards to both the co-main and main. No performance of the night award, so they give the Fight of the Night award to Gaslam and Adesanya, and then to Poirier and Holloway. I thought that was the right call as well.
I would say so, yeah. On any given night, we'd be talking about that main event as potentially Fight of the Year, but it just happened to happen on the other Fight of the Year.
All right. Great stuff, my man. Pleasure as always. Thanks to all of you for watching our coverage all week long from here in Atlanta. As you can tell behind us, they are breaking things down, so it is time to go. Thank you so much. Congratulations, Dustin Poirier. Congratulations, Israel Adesanya. We'll see you next week for a whole lot more things to talk about, I am sure, in the crazy world of MMA. Good night from Atlanta.